Hello and welcome to this new session where we are going to discuss the peroxisomes and the related lysosomes. So mainly our focus here is going to be on these two organelles that are similar in functions and somehow in structure. These two are similar in structure to lysosomes or the lysozymes, but when you look at the peroxisomes, our peroxisomes are smaller in size. And the peroxisomes are also called the microbodies, which have many oxidases or oxidase enzymes. What do oxidase enzymes do? Oxidase enzymes remove hydrogen atoms or protons or hydrogen ions from various organic substances, for example, from amino acids and fatty acids. We see them actually being oxidized in the peroxisomes as part of the normal metabolism in our bodies. The enzymes within these peroxisomes also oxidize toxic substances such as drugs, drug overdoses, poisonous or toxic chemicals that we ingest through food or through drinks, excess alcohol, and so many other toxic compounds are oxidized within these organelles by the actions of their enzymes. We see peroxisomes being numerous in the river, where detoxification of those chemicals like drugs, alcohol, and other toxins take place. Remember, in our basic biology, we looked at the river and its functions, and we went ahead to find out that the river is the most or the highly metabolic organ in the body, performing more than 500 functions within the body. So likewise, our chemicals, the drugs, the foods that we eat on daily basis are metabolized within the liver and by the help of this organelle, especially when it comes to toxic compounds. This organelle, the peroxisome, also contains the catalase enzyme, which decomposes the hydrogen peroxide. And because production and degradation of hydrogen peroxide occur within the same organelle, we see peroxisomes protecting other parts of the cell from the toxic effects of hydrogen peroxide. Then we need to appreciate another fact about this peroxisome or the peroxisomes, like the mitochondria, like what we are going to say about the mitochondria. Lysosomes, the relatives of peroxisomes, lysosomes undergo also self-division, or they do self-replicate, forming new lysosomes and peroxisomes like that. So these two categories, peroxisomes and lysosomes, do self-replicate like the mitochondria. They do self-replicate like the mitochondria. So we see also new peroxisomes forming from the pre-existing ones by enlarging and dividing. For example, I'm going to give you an example that we shall be actually applying regularly in the study of our pharmacology, particularly in the drug doses and toxicity. You will see that, for example, if I'm naive, if I have not been drinking any alcohol at all, and today maybe I happen to drink a bottle, maybe like 0.5 liters, or 1 liter of alcohol that has maybe like 6.5 alcohol concentration in that volume, I might get drunk. I get drunk, of course I'll get drunk, I'll feel high, I feel actually satisfied, I start actually become very jolly, I gain the other euphoric state. But with the time, you'll see that dose or that one liter, the moment I keep on drinking regularly and maintaining the same dose, the same amount of 1 liter, time comes whereby that 1 liter fails to give me the other actually highness, the other euphoric mood, the other excitation mood and general happiness, and eventually I will graduate to the third bottle and the fourth and the vivid like that with the time. And in the process, of course, I'll talk like a layman. I'll say that I'm used now to alcohol. This amount, I can take even 5 bottles. I started with 2 bottles, but at the moment, my body is used. I can now tolerate 5 or 6 bottles, much as it is stronger. So what do you think happens? Where do you think we gain actually the acclimatization and actually the endurance? It's because the more we keep on taking those doses, the more our hepatocytes keep on also enabling the synthesis or the replication of more peroxisomes and lysosomes, resulting from the production of more oxidase enzymes, which quicken actually the process of degradation of such chemicals, alcohol and other drugs, rendering them actually harmless and actually less efficacious or effective. That's how we keep on actually getting acclimatized to more bottles. We keep on actually upgrading like that because of such effects, because of the ability of the peroxisomes to replicate themselves, because of the lysosomes to replicate themselves, hence producing more oxidase enzymes. So, before we go far, we also need to note in details that lysosomes are bigger in size than the peroxisomes. That's why when you look at this illustration of our body cell, you see that the lysosome is bigger in size. Look at this, and when you look at our peroxisome is smaller in size compared to our lysosome. So you need to note that they are like sisters and brothers, they are related organelles, they perform similar functions, but we are going to see that the lysosomes slightly differ in function. So as you see this, as you look at the peroxisome, it is smaller than our lysosome here. So much as they are sisters, much as they are brothers, much as they are related actual organelles, you see that the lysosomes actually produce even more other enzymes that are not only oxidases, but also actually proteases. They also synthesize proteases, very, very powerful proteases. These are enzymes that break down most proteinaceous substances within our bodies. And for example, you see that the white blood cells, like the neutrophils, the macrophages, and those others that are phagocytic in nature, have a high concentration of lysosomes, and these lysosomes participate or they help in producing those protease enzymes. And the moment a neutrophil, for example, a macrophage, has phagocytosed maybe a bacteria, it releases those enzymes into what we call a phagosome containing that bacteria, and bacteria actually breaks down into so many pieces which are later later on presented as antigens. But that one occurs with, presentation occurs within the macrophages, not within the neutrophils. Don't misquote me. Presentation of those broken down antigens, those small pieces from the bacteria or any other parasite, presentation to the bosses, those are the T lymphocytes, particularly the CD4 serums, occurs within that activity is carried out by the macrophages, but not within the neutrophils. But you need to appreciate that at this point that both the neutrophils and macrophages contain a large concentration of these organelles, especially the lysosomes, that you produce large amounts of protease enzymes that are used to kill the invading, actually phagocytose, the bacteria or pathogens during the process of immunological protection and immunological activities. The way the name is sounding, the proteasomes, protea, referring to proteins. Proteasomes comes from the word, of course, proteins. So proteasomes. So they contain protein degrading enzymes that are referred to as proteases. They come from proteins like you can hear protea, then proteases. Yeases, that suffix ases refers to enzymes. So as we are going to see, these organelles contain a high concentration of enzymes called proteases, protein degrading, protein breaking, protein digesting enzymes. Proteasomes do degrade proteins delivered to them in vesicles. Cytosolic proteins also require disposal at certain times in life of a cell. Like my dear brothers and sisters, in our houses where we reside, we usually have dust bins. All the wastes that we have, that we are disposing of, we first, for example, put them in the dustbins for some time, and then the following day or after like 2 days, we take them to be disposed into the compost pits for destruction, maybe through compost refitting or through incineration, like that, you know, types of waste disposal. In our offices, we also have our dustbins where we throw actually the waste paper and so many other materials that we no longer need. In schools, we also have dustbins. Within our cities, we have various points in where we find the dustbins. When we go to the banks, we find dustbins. When we go to video horrors or cinema horrors, we find dustbins. When we go to the bars, we find dustbins. Where unwanted materials, unwanted wastes are usually actually dumped and later on disposed of and destroyed or recycled, like that. Likewise, our body cells also have mechanisms through which various unwanted wastes or products are disposed of or destroyed like that. And you see that in some cases they can be recycled. But in this case, most unwanted proteins and unwanted waste products here are not recycled. So when you look at our proteasomes, we have them looking like cylinders. They look like cylinders or pipes, of course, with some compartments that do the job. Like, for example, when you look at the grinding mill, we have pieces of metals that are, of course, in that chamber that keeps on crushing the grains, maize grains, legumes like peanuts, it can be sorghum, it can be wheat. So you have that chamber, when you look at the grinding mill, that, of course, has, of course, is rotated by a powerful electric motor or a powerful engine connected. Of course, usually there's a conveyor belt, you know. So as the rotation of those powerful grinders begin within that chamber, as they meet those grains, they crush them more into flour, the final product that we need. Likewise, within our proteasomes, we have systems, of course, of enzymes that we call the proteases. So the proteases, the moment those unwanted proteins enter the proteasomes, the proteases begin their action, they begin their activity of crushing them. So you'll see along the way as we discuss and enjoy these organelles, you'll see that when proteasomes fail, it becomes actually a disaster, it becomes a catastrophe. We see some diseases emerging from the failure of the proteasomes doing their work. From the moment they fail to perform their work, their normal work, the moment these proteases fail to do their job, it becomes a catastrophe, as we are going to see in the discussion, the detailed discussion of this organelle. So allow me to have this simple illustration whereby we are depicting the shape of our proteasomes. This is how they look like. This is our simple structure. This is how they look like in shape and in histology. So we also need to appreciate that these proteasomes were discovered of recent, not many decades ago, but just like maybe 25 years back, that's when they were discovered. You see that, like I said, they degrade proteins delivered to them in vesicles, and they are found, actually, this, when you look at the cytosolic proteins or cytoplasmic proteins, also require disposal, like I said, at certain times in the life of a cell. So continuous destruction of unneeded, damaged, or fatty proteins, like, for example, hormones, for example, proteins that are resulting from the wearing off of the body cells and tissues, are the function of actually should be disposed. So we see that the function of these barrel-shaped structures consisting of stacks of rings of proteins within their centers, containing large amounts of proteases, we see them helping us to dispose of or to destroy those unwanted proteins. For example, proteins that are part of metabolic pathways, like enzymes, are degraded after they have accomplished their function, and such protein destruction plays a part in negative feedback by halting pathways, by helping the pathways once the appropriate response has been achieved. For example, when proteinaceous hormones, protein hormones, peptide hormones have achieved their functions, they must be destroyed. Most of them are destroyed. However, we will see in some cases whereby some are recycled. When the enzymes have performed their functions, when they have aged, because enzymes in most cases they are not used up at the end of the reactions, like, you know, but of course they also have a certain point when they age and when they are worn out, therefore they must be destroyed and actually disposed of and new ones come up. The same applies also to neurotransmitters. When neurotransmitters in the nervous system function, you see them when some of them have actually achieved their functions, they are destroyed. However, we shall see some of them all being recycled. Like, for example, I think in the category of monoamines somewhere, they are recycled. So, you see, we keep on actually seeing a typical body cell with the hundreds of thousands of proteasomes. I mean, with thousands of proteasomes, not hundreds of thousands, but at least they reach a thousand. A typical body cell can contain like a thousand to one, like from 1,000 to about 5,000 proteasomes in both the cytosol and also within the nucleus. This time, the nucleus also has the proteasomes. So that is that shows us how serious they are, how the function of disposing of unwanted proteins is actually fundamental. And as I said, I told you that they were discovered recently, like 20 to 25 years back. And they are very, very small in that they are very difficult to observe under ordinary light microscope. And they are not also clearly visible even when we use electron microscopes or under electron micrographs. Like we have seen, our proteasomes were named so because they have a myriad proteases, they have multiple protease enzymes that cut proteins into small peptides for disposal or for easy disposal. Once the enzymes of the proteasome have chopped up a protein into smaller chunks, other enzymes then break down the peptides into smaller amino acids, which can be recycled into new proteins or totally disposed of. Like I gave you an example of sweeping, they will sweep our office rooms, they will sweep our sitting rooms or bedrooms, and we put the unwanted actually wastes into the dust bins. Of course, at first, the first step is the small dust bin that might be within the sitting room. Then from there, we take to the compost pit, and within the compost pit, those wastes can be burned, can be incinerated, can be actually buried underground, maybe through ground, we call it composting. There is a certain actual through landfill, like that. So we see that within these stacks or within these shelves, if you look at our proteasome, it has those stacks or shelves, and within these shelves, it's where we have actually various wastes in the form of especially in the form of proteins. They are thrown there, and the moment they reach there, our proteases, our massive proteases, act on them, breaking them down into smaller components, into smaller pieces of proteins that can be easily broken down, that can be easily disposed of by the body. Like I said, we see, of course, some of these byproducts are being thrown away as rubbish, as waste. Others can be recycled. So basically, we have our systems, our sanitation systems within our environments, within our homes, within our cities and towns. They will have those sanitary systems. They will have sewage plants and storage plants that where unwanted all that water from our latrines, toilets, are recycled. We see actually that water being sent into sewage plants, being purified and recycled for use like that. And in the end, we form things like leachate, which can be used as the manure and the fertilizers like that. Then the water component being recycled because at that point it is safer for use like that. So this is actually how our proteasomes do the work of actually keep on cleaning, maintaining the internal environment, maintaining the internal environmental sanitation within our bodies. So we see that some diseases do result from the failure of proteasomes to degrade such abnormal proteins. So when our proteasomes fail to degrade some of the proteins, what usually happens is a disaster. We see, for example, the clumps of misfolded proteins tend to accumulate in the brain cells, the neurons of people with Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, and others like Huntington's disease, and other dementias. So when such misfolded proteins accumulate and your proteases fail to degrade them, usually such diseases result. And discovering why the proteasomes fail to clear these abnormal proteins is a goal of the ongoing research. And us and ourselves, we keep on actually, we need to keep on actually doing detailed researches so that at the end we're able to come up with the actually the detailed pathogenesis and pathology of these diseases. And in the end, when we find out the exact point where there is a defect, we can be able to develop drugs that that we can use in the total management, in the total treatment, or in the total cure of these diseases. Like I said, Those diseases include Alzheimer's disease. We have Parkinson's disease. We have diseases like Huntington disease, and other categories of dementias. Generally, we group these diseases. We put them in the category of neurodegenerative diseases. Neurodegenerative disorders or diseases. We also need not to forget the prion diseases. Prion diseases. Prion diseases such as in this case you have fetal familial insomnia. Fetal familial insomnia. We have fetal familial FFI1. We have fetal familial insomnia 1 and 2 and some other variants. So what exactly happens here? Like I'll give you an example of when we focus at Alzheimer's disease. I don't know whether the spelling is correct. Maybe we are going to check. And I think there is a letter I that is missing here. Yes, letter I is missing. It was missing, and Alzheimer's disease. Yes, I think this is the correct spelling. Yes. Within in individuals in the brains and the brain neurons of individuals with the Alzheimer's disease, we see proteins like tau, the A tau protein. A tau protein accumulating within those neurons, and in the end it causes the negative function because it is not cleared. It cannot be degraded by our proteasomes with their proteases. So we find that our A tau protein accumulating within the neurons of the victims of this who are suffering from this disease. And in the end, of course, as these proteins, these abnormal proteins, misfolded proteins keep on accumulating, the disease also keeps on actually progressing with the time, and eventually death occurs. So the accumulated tau proteins usually come together forming actually what you call amyloid plates. Amyloid plates. It's better to understand more about these diseases. We need to keep on reading our medicine in details, the medicine of these diseases. We need to read the pathology of these diseases, what exactly happens at the cellular level for the greater understanding of this subchapter. Then our tau proteins keep on accumulating, resulting into the formation of what we call the beta amyloid plaques within the neurons and progressively impairing the functioning of our brains in Alzheimer's disease. When we look at Parkinson's disease, in Parkinson's disease, usually there is a failure by a group of neurons to secrete a neurotransmitter called dopamine. Dopamine is generally an inhibitory neurotransmitter in the central nervous system, and it helps us to oppose the actions, the excitatory actions of acetylcholine activities. Therefore, when it is deficient, when dopamine is deficient in Parkinson's disease, what happens is that acetylcholine keeps on exciting the muscles, causing actually hypercontraction, resulting into rigidity of the muscles. So acetylcholine remains unopposed, and every time doing its work, but unopposed. So in the process, you find that muscles are usually rigid, resulting into a shuffling gait because muscles can contract, but relaxation becomes very, very hard. So in the process, you find that the muscles are rigid. That's how end up actually patients having a shuffling gait, short steps, but short and fast steps, which you describe as a shuffling gait in patients. Then also rigidity of the trunk muscles, then shaking because of excitatory activity of acetylcholine that is unopposed, and like that. So within the brain, there is what we call the Negro striatal pathway. Like they will have the northern bypass. They have Entebbe Express, Kampala Entebbe Express Highway. So we have also a certain pathway within the brain, which is called Negro, from the Negro. Negro striatal pathway. So within the Negro striatal pathway, we have a large network of neurons that secrete the neurotransmitter dopamine neurotransmitter within the Negro striatal pathway. Negro from BRCA substance pathway. So within the Negro striatal pathway, we have a vast network of neurons which secrete dopamine neurotransmitter. So what exactly happens is that the moment abnormal proteins start accumulating, of course, the moment our proteasomes fail to degrade those abnormal proteins that accumulate within those neurons, they cause what we call accelerated oxidative stress of these neurons, and they end up degenerating and dying. And the moment they die, that's when we start having insufficient levels of dopamine in your transmitter, which is inhibitory in nature, resulting into Parkinson's disease. And those proteins, I think they are referred to as, are they called the Lewy bodies? You go and read about Lewy bodies. You read about Lewy bodies. In neurology, you go and read about Lewy bodies. You'll be able to appreciate the details about Parkinson's disease. Then the same also happens in Huntington's disease, same abnormal proteins and other dementias. Then in addition to Lewy bodies, you need to add on neurofibrillary tangles. Neurofibrillary tangles, neurofibrillary tangles, and you see what they do, how they cause damage as well. So with the still prion, when we look at the prion diseases, prions can be acquired, can enter our bodies exogenously from the food that we eat. For example, from some meats, there are some animals, of course, like sheep, cattle, those ones can be infected by prion diseases. Like for example, there is a disease called the scrapie in sheep. There is a disease called the mad cow disease, or called the bovine spongiform encephalopathy, or encephalopathy, BSE, that affects the cattle, but it is common in some parts of Europe, like United Kingdom, but also in Africa. You never know. In some, I think you have it, only that maybe our veterinary researchers are not, maybe they are a bit relaxed a bit. Maybe they don't do a lot of researches in that area, but all in all, we need to appreciate that bovine spongiform encephalopathy is a bit common, and together with the scrapie that affects the sheep. So if we happen to persistently consume such meats, especially when they're half cooked, when we can end up actually consuming those proteins and those abnormal proteins from such meats. And what happens that, remember, you need to know that you need to know that the prion proteins or prions are very, very difficult to destroy. The only method that we destroy these prions, the prion proteins easily, is through actually autoclaving at high temperatures, of course, between 130 degrees and 160 degrees for a duration of like 30 minutes. 30 to 45 minutes. So those are the temperatures at which you can be sure that those prions have been destroyed, rendering them harmless. Therefore, like we have said, that we can acquire prions from the exogenous source, from the outside of the body, through those meats that I have mentioned. When we consume them, when they are half cooked, we can end up with some of those issues. Then the prion proteins can also be generated de novo from out of the blue, from scratch within your brain neurons. Like, for example, when some of those proteins when they are misfolded, we can end up with the conditions like fetal familial insomnia 1, 2, and the other variants.